Hey, everybody, how are you? It's Jeff and Joelle with episode number 3 of Real Talk, where we spend at least an hour talking about usually a single subject, which allows us to go much deeper into concepts, learning theory, where all of our other Q&As are pretty short answers. And we're really, really excited to do this one because a lot of people that contact us, they always contact us about the dog's bad behavior, but they go down the list of obedience commands the dog's knows. And I'm like, that has sort of nothing to do with it. So your child can get straight A's in school, be in sports, but still be like, get into fights every day or be a shoplifter or commit crimes or, you know, be hooked on drugs or, you know, things like that. So we can, I really want to really get into talking about a lot of that stuff and what the difference is. So what would you think, you know, again, that whole theory, Joelle, that a lot of people are relying on, if that's the right word, do you feel that people are relying on obedience to just have a well-rounded, good relationship with their dog? What more do they need than that? And what is the difference?
I think a ton of people are relying on obedience. How many times do you see a dog rush the door and owner's like, sit, place, they're barking all these commands at them. The dog doesn't give a shit. Like there's a big difference when a dog's in that state of mind. Now we're talking about a behavioral issue. Charging the door is a behavioral issue.
Right.
Obedience isn't going to stop that.
Right.
And I think that, you know, knowing commands, of course, is important.
Absolutely.
You use your commands every single day. You
right.
take them to shops and take them on walks and things like that. But unfortunately, I think a lot of people go to, you know, dog training class and the training stops as soon as that 60 minutes is over.
And it's focused on obedience, like 5 obedience commands. Now, let's go back to the door thing. So your dog rushes the front door and you go up to the front door and you tell it, place or out. It listens to you.
Mm-hmm.
That's fine. But your dog should have never rushed the front door in the first place. That's where we come into behavior. Behavior is when your dog knows its command, so it knows it down, but a little kid runs by and it bites the kid. It's like, now not only did the dog break the obedience command, so we can leverage obedience a little bit, but even if you broke the command, you shouldn't have jumped on the person, bitten the kid, chased the dog, chased the cat. So, and I think most people, their biggest complaint is if they really, like, once we tell them the difference is, you just have a badly behaved dog.
Mm-hmm.
Some dogs are dangerous. Some dogs are unacceptable use of the mouth.
Right.
But a lot of it is like there was that one dog that knew 20 obedience commands, but it didn't know don't bite people.
Mm-hmm.
So none of those commands sort of mattered.
Right.
So, of course, I know you want and I want an obedient dog, you know, 5 basic commands. And I want them to know them in high levels of distraction. But I also don't want a pushy, a snotty, a fearful, an anxious, an aggressive dog. That's behavior.
Mm-hmm.
So I think what a lot of people are doing is when their dog is behaving badly, they're going to obedience to stop it when they actually should be doing behavior modification. What actually is behavior modification, Joelle?
So behavior is behavior is behavior. It's the way your dog acts at its own free will without you giving it a command. So I think the perfect example is I think we've all seen or maybe even owned that dog. I did own that dog, Bert, who was he super obedient as far as like training? No, he's just a great dog.
Right.
He wouldn't hurt a fly. He's never jumped on people.
Right.
Loved kids, great with other dogs.
Right.
I didn't train any of that.
Right.
That was just the dog.
The dog, right.
That was his behavior.
Right.
Now, could he hold it down, say, and recall? Yes, but that was about the extent of his training.
Right. He actually
never needed anything more than that because he was just an easy, good dog.
Right.
A well-behaved dog.
Luck of the draw.
Yeah.
Because you actually got him from like...
I got him on Craigslist.
On Craigslist.
When I was 18 years
old. Right, exactly. And people pay thousands of dollars. Well, that's another thing we should talk about. Spending $5,000 for a dog, which is fine if you want to. I have no problem with people buying dogs from breeders. None whatsoever. That's not my thing. You know, spay and neuter is not my thing. You know, adopt, don't shop is not my thing. I'm like, if you want a good dog, you have the right to get that dog from wherever you want.
Yeah.
But the price of the dog and where it came from historically will hopefully get you a well temperament, good physical structure dog. But you still got to train it.
Yes.
Because look at you. You got a dog off Craigslist, mm-hmm. most likely from a backyard breeder, right? And it literally was the best dog you've ever had. Meanwhile, people are spending, and we know, we get these people, they're spending $5,000 to $10,000 on a dog who is a wreck.
Yeah.
A wreck. So was that genetic or was that nurture? Was it because the owner was like, I spent all this money on the dog, so I really don't have to focus on the training and stopping the bad behavior.
That's a huge lie that's told out there, especially with like your family-friendly dogs, your Goldens, right. your Doodles. Oh, they're just great dogs. You don't have to even train them. Right. And then owners are left with like this nightmare of a dog because you do have to train them.
Yes. Yes.
And you do have to teach them right from wrong, and you do have to train them proper behavior.
Right. You just hit on a really important point, right from wrong. A lot of people are focusing on training all the behaviors, the obedience commands, I should say.
Yeah.
But that's all reward-based. Like we use a reward-based system. We use positive reinforcement. We clicker train. We use a lot of food.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, great. Now your dog knows down, place, sit, recall, and heal. But does it know it, number one, for long periods of time, for all your duration stuff? Does it know it around high levels of distraction? And does it know a lot of that stuff almost as default without actually being told to do it? Mm-hmm. So that's the obedience. Like in my, like we're actually about to start doing some VIP exclusive training in Sarasota, Florida, which is going to be geared towards no aggression, not massive separation anxiety. But when we went to, like, we're going to Sarasota tonight, for instance, when we go there, there's so many outdoor cafes.
Mm-hmm.
There's dogs on boats.
Yep.
There's dogs at the beach. And we want everybody to have that dog that can go to an outdoor cafe for breakfast, lunch, or dinner, go into a 2-hour downstay or more, and not care about the world. We want the dogs to be able to, you know, be in a downstay, and if a dog goes by, it doesn't care. Kid on a scooter, kid on a bike, waiter, waitress comes up, doesn't care.
Mm-hmm.
And we want you to be able to walk through a city center. So, and there's a lot of dogs. We've already gone over this about how heel has got nothing to do with leash reactivity. It's like also like stay in command, you know? So I think what a lot of folks are doing is they're relying too much on obedience, which is all your yes training.
Mm-hmm.
They're not proofing it, which is your no training.
Right.
And they're absolutely not doing, they're changing the dog's behavior, which is almost punitive.
Yeah.
Is step one, at least. Is step one. Because then once the dog starts doing it well, then you can do rewards. But you're not going to reward your dog out of the bad behavior. Step one, which is a 1 to 3 second conversation, that absolutely is going to be a no.
I think a big thing I see a lot too is a lot of people are using obedience to almost manage behavior. And there's nothing wrong with management. I feel like that word gets thrown around and people get really triggered by it.
Right.
There's nothing wrong with management.
No.
I crate my dog. He thrives with structure. Like that's fine. When he's in the house, he's either in a down or like on his bed on place. However, I personally, as a dog trainer, want my dogs to know that even when you're out of command, you make good choices.
Right.
I shouldn't have to always be telling you what to do. If I tell you break, if I tell Wes break, he's going to just go lay down somewhere.
Right. Yes.
He's going to default to a good behavior.
Right.
And that's the same for all of our training dogs at the center too. Like they get to the point where, you know, we say break and they just do good things.
Right.
That's the way we tell, are you truly trained? Have we truly changed your behavior?
Right.
We'll take them to the park on a 30-foot long line, a dog that used to be explosively reactive, or even drop the line. We'll be like, okay, go.
Make your choices. And I think that's what...
they make a good choice.
I think that's what a lot of folks are... when we say management, I think there's a lot of misconceptions about it, especially us, but a lot of people, it's like... you're actually not teaching the dog anything. It's like, actually, we do teach dogs. That's like our basic program to make better decisions.
On their own.
On their own with no guidance or prompting from us. Now, a good example is this. A lot of people struggle with like, so Like right now, we have three dogs all around us, and they're all just lying down. Now, they're big dogs. This morning, let's talk about that. So we just did a bunch of filming of something else. We're going to be filming this, and then we're also going to be doing some brainstorming. It's probably going to be about 3 hours worth of work, and we're going to make lunch. Mm-hmm. It's lunchtime right now. I don't know about you, but I'm getting hungry. So I think it's like, can we eat snacks during this show?
Why not? It's our show.
Yeah, it's like they're always eating snacks. I mean, Angelo gets to eat freaking fruit while he's doing his homework. I mean, why can't we have snacks? So I think what I want to tell people is, so you have your dog do a 3 hour downstay when you're doing this recording. And I'm like, well, let me tell you about 6:30 this morning. Mm-hmm. They went outside. I woke them up. They went outside. They went to the bathroom, and it's right about getting light. So I put them in my truck. I take them to the ocean. They swim in the ocean. They do a good dozen chuck it sessions, and they go out pretty far. And then they probably do a good 6 to 8 land chuck it sessions, because that dries them off as well as, you know, tires them out. And then we come back to the house, and Tex and Wes, I put slip leads on them. I get my bike out, and I do about a 15-minute but very hard, you know, not 35 miles per hour, but a very hard bike ride where they're in a good trot. Now, that's all done within an hour and a half. Mm-hmm. They're all set for 4 to 5 hours. Mm-hmm. And then we'll swim them in the pool twice during the day. And then at night, we go for a really nice, long walk. But the rest of the time, what do? They just hang out, either by command or by default. Why? Because we've instilled it into them that, like, you don't just roam around this house looking for things to get into. You don't stare out the window waiting for things to go by. In fact, how many times on our walks at night in the neighborhood? So we do a walk in the neighborhood, and then we do a walk on the beach. Well, it's not on the beach, it's a sidewalk next to the beach. But how many times do we walk by these houses where there's dogs in the houses going ballistic?
Just for us passing by.
Passing by.
I can't imagine.
And we can't even see the dogs. Yeah. So I don't even know where they are. I mean, they're in the house.
Yeah.
But it's like ballistic. And then we hear them in the background.
Yep.
So we're talking about a good 3 minutes of nonstop barking. And they probably do that with every single person and dog that walks by. Why nobody stops that, I don't know. Now, somebody can say, oh, they're friendly. Fine. They probably are. They could be friendly. They know commands. They're great snugglers on the couch. They actually might stay close to me when I'm outside. Mm-hmm. But your dogs are like a pain in the ass, frankly, which a lot of people get, oh my God, you're calling a dog a pain in the ass. I'm like, yeah, that's a pain in the ass. So
let's talk about in the home behavior,
right?
Stuff we expect from our dogs. So in the house, I expect my dog not to counter surf.
Yep.
Not to get on the furniture. Yep. That's just my rule. If you want to have a different rule, that's fine, but not on the furniture without my permission.
Well, I don't think anybody wants their dog to counter surf, but
I'm talking about the couch furniture. Definitely. I expect them not to eat shoes that are sitting by the front door. There's a good 3 pairs over there, my Vivo Barefoots, which are not cheap.
Not to eat anything.
And I expect him not to chew on furniture, okay? Yeah. So those are the big ones. That's the big 4. How do you stop your dog from doing all that?
You have to learn the art of a proper correction.
And not just put them on a place bed and expect them to not, oh, well, they know a good place, so they won't ever do any of that stuff.
Right. So what happens with a lot of people is they'll see the dog, say, eating shoes, getting in the trash, getting on the counter, and what they'll do is they'll give them an obedience command. Well, they might say no, or they might say off, or they might say leave it. Mm-hmm. But then they just tell them an obedience command. I'm like, but your dog's going to do that tomorrow.
And you're still present. How do you get your dog to do it when you're not there?
How do you get your dog to not do those things when you are not around and make a better choice? A very firm application of a punisher. Now, that's the trigger word for a lot of people, because a lot of people think that means abuse. It actually thinks you're yelling at the dog. Actually, we don't yell at dogs.
Never.
We don't yell at dogs at all. That's why we love our tools. And the thing is, but a lot of people also are shamed for crating their dog when they leave the house.
So that's the thing, though. I'm not, I think everybody should crate their dog when they leave the house. But I'm just saying, let's say your dog is in the kitchen and you're like, oh, I got to go grab something from the bedroom. And in that amount of time, how many dogs would counter surf?
So many.
Right. So now this is what I'm saying. Just for your in-home behavior, you can stop that.
Yeah. Going to the bathroom. They can't even go to the bathroom without coming out to a mess.
Exactly. Yes. Like, you can stop that. Yes. With you being in the home, your presence means you don't do X, Y, or Z.
Now, this is another trigger for a lot of people. How do you actually stop it?
Right. So that's the uncomfortable part. Nobody wants to really talk
about. I'm not going to wait till my dog does it. I'm actually going to, we have a phrase which really, really triggers people. We set the dogs up to fail just so we can have that educational moment. Because I'm not going to take a chance that my dog gets my cell phone or those really nice sunglasses you have or those beautiful shoes. And they're just sneakers. They're not like, you know, Louis Vuitton shoes or something like that. So that's a good shoe. I don't know.
Yes.
But what you're going to do is you have to set them up to fail if you actually want to change their behavior, if they're exhibiting this behavior, just so you can have the conversation of not to do that. Just like you, when you want to train an obedience command, you set your dog up to succeed.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you're going to the proofing stage, you set the dog up,
set them up to fail.
Mm-hmm. Or else they won't be able to behave in public. So I think a lot of people, I mean, so many people can relate to this is my dog listens in class, but as soon as I leave the classroom, my dog doesn't listen. I'm like, I know, because you're in a sterile environment. Now, we do start dogs in sterile environments, but that's just to teach the basics.
Yeah, we get them out of there real quick.
Now, let's go to the real world. And now the real education actually starts. So now a lot of people are not doing that. Or they'll say, you know, as long as there's no dogs around, my dog will behave. I'm like, you should be actually hunting down dogs then.
Yeah.
You know? So.
Yeah, I think that's all just huge. And that's how you get a dog that just makes better choices without you micromanaging every – because I don't want to micromanage my dog.
Right.
Like, I want him to just know, like, you don't do these things. I want you to do these things.
Right.
But – they don't know until you tell them.
Here's
how would a dog ever know?
Right. Is this management? So we have a cage over the swimming pool here in Florida. Okay. The dogs are outside lying down on dog beds right now. Angelo, he's in charge of like putting them outside the cage for the potty area.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, Angelo, will you let the dogs out? He opens up the door, lets them out. And I'm like, is that management or is that just protocol? It's like, why is that bad? Like, why is that bad? I'm not going to wait for them to tell me they need to go out. It's like, no, go out to the bathroom. You'll be out there for 5 to 10 minutes and then come back in.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what is so bad about that?
I don't know. It's like everybody manages their household in one way or another.
Right.
But for some reason, when it comes to managing your dog, it's like this bad thing. But I think management gets that bad connotation because people use it as like almost a band-aid for behavior.
Here's another good example of how you can leverage obedience to have a better behaved dog. All the dogs that we drive, whether it's personal dogs or at the training center that are in a vehicle, we put them in downstays and they have to stay in a downstay.
Mm-hmm.
Now, why? Why can't they just like behave when they're sitting up? Because it's bigger than that. We know that a dog that's lying down is going to be less stressed, less anxious, and better behaved. So can we make that dog better behaved sitting up? Sure. But remember, these are also clients' dogs. And that's the big thing around with dog trainers is just because when you start talking about your personal dogs, and we just did talk about our personal dogs, but we're also working with clients' dogs, like 10,000 clients' dogs over the last 20 years. We know that what we do with these dogs, I don't want to say big deal, but it really has nothing to do with a client's success because we do have to give them a good foundation.
Mm-hmm.
But sorry, but your average dog owner is not going to have the skill set of a dog trainer, nor do they need to.
Right.
So I think it's a little bit of a, when you see videos of us working with a client's dogs, a lot of them are doing well by the time they go home. But what's the handoff look like? Even though the owner's already gotten, they get 6 hours of training because the dogs have a relationship with the owner of, I don't listen to you. So that's where the human also has to change their behavior as well.
Yes.
So there's so much actually involved. And nobody wants to talk about this stuff. Nobody wants to, I mean, it's all dog training, but it's like obedience is a small part of it.
Yeah.
And I would rather, frankly, look at Bert.
Yeah.
He always stuck around. He came back, not like a racehorse though, but he came back. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? He never got into a dog fight.
Never.
He was always followed us off leash. He was good around.
Good in the car. Good everywhere.
Good everywhere.
That dog
but
on the ATV.
So I would call him a well-behaved dog.
Yeah.
Put him in a competition obedience ring, he'd come in last place.
Yeah.
But what's our lifestyle?
Right.
Our lifestyle is an off-leash lifestyle.
Where you need to be safe.
And he also didn't bark out windows. He didn't bark out the car. And it's just like, and it's not because he was exercised into, you know, good behavior. He was well behaved. Now, is that you got him as a puppy, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So was that the luck of the draw? Or did you just put a ton of work into him at the beginning that I'm not putting up with your crap?
Yeah, but it was for more of the behavioral stuff.
Right.
I didn't care about, like, I didn't know there was even like e-collars and all that stuff.
Right.
I'm just like, I'm working full time. You can't do this. You can't do this. You can't do this. You can't do this.
Right.
But besides that, we're going to have a great time together.
Right. Exactly. Like,
and that was it. I was 18. I just moved out of the house. I'm like, I'm going to get a puppy. And like, I just took him everywhere with me.
Yeah.
He did everything with me. And anytime he misbehaved, it was like taken care of. Like,
there was a consequence.
There was a consequence.
And I think that's another thing that when you say the word taken care of,
yeah,
like, how long did it take you to take care of that problem?
A second. A leash pop.
Right.
Like
86,400 seconds in a day. That's another misconception about correcting dogs. People think you're yelling, screaming, putting them in timeout, being mad at them, being mean. But it's like, no.
Not at all.
It's just a 1 to 3 second conversation and then you're done.
Mm-hmm.
Let's move on with life.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we need to move on with life. Like, I want to be doing stuff with my dogs and I don't want to like nag them, nor do I want to like hold it against them. It's like,
yeah.
No.
That's the other thing too. A lot of, you know, we talk about like nurture or nature. Burton, if you guys have been following us long enough, you know Bert. If most people met him, they're like, wow, that's a confident, really chill dog. Like, that's a good dog. But when I got him at 8 or 9 weeks old, he was beyond skittish.
Right.
He was hiding under things, didn't want to come out, didn't want to come out of his crate. He was the last to be picked out of the whole litter.
Right.
Obviously, like, nobody wanted him because he was so, like, skittish and weird. But I just made him do stuff with me.
Right.
I'm like, you're going to come everywhere with me. I'm taking him to kids' playgrounds. We're running up and down the playgrounds. He's going down the slide with me. Like, I just did everything with that dog since the minute I got him. And I never let his story, oh, he's a fearful, scared puppy,
right,
get in the way.
Holding
I'm like, you're
going to
be an amazing dog, and you're just going to live life with me.
Let's talk about that. Let's talk about, so, confidence building, definitely, it's more about good behavior and then it is obedience. So confidence building is actually a skill that you also need to do with your dog.
Yes.
And confidence building is you took your nervous, fearful, anxious dog and you pretty much was like, you know, it's like when you say, I made you do it. It's like, oh, so you forced him, you grabbed him by the scruff and made him do it. It's like, no, you used a leash.
Yeah.
And you're like, you know what? Yeah, you're afraid of going up 2 steps? Get over it, frankly.
Yeah.
And guess what? The first time, does it look a little bit messy? Sure. But guess what? Third, fourth time, the dog's just like, I'll just keep going up these steps.
Yep.
And that passes on to a lot of other fearful activities where when you build the dog's confidence in one or two things, that starts the shrapnel effect. They start doing better overall.
Every single dog for the most part is afraid of water at first. You get them in, they swim. They're like, this is actually amazing.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
Thank you.
All I can speak is like, again, like Tex, he's a Malinois. He dives off of docks.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't do dock diving.
He dives off the pool.
Off the pool. He doesn't care. He'll like dive over a dog on top of a dog. A dog will dive on top of him. Yeah. But it's like, but at the first time I taught him, the day I taught him how to swim, he was deathly. You put on the brakes. Actually, put the brakes on. It was so hard for me to do it, but I've got a great way to teach dogs how to swim. I do it on the first session.
Yeah.
And we've got free videos on YouTube, by the way, if anybody's interested on that, for above ground, below ground, and open water swimming. But the first time we did it.
Yeah, I'm sure. Scared.
He was scared. But what did I do? I made him do it.
Yeah.
And he got over it. Why? Proper leadership. I'm not dragging you through fire.
And that's the thing, like obedience. We use it to help dogs get more confidence, absolutely.
Yes.
But more so when we're giving dogs confidence, it's because we're just like, let's go.
Yes.
We're going out. We're doing the thing.
Yes.
Sorry you're a little bit nervous right now, but I promise tomorrow will be better. Yes. And it usually is.
And we can leverage obedience to get a dog over fear. For instance, your dog is afraid of loud noises.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. As most people know, when a dog is in a fear state, it won't take a food reward. It won't take a ball. It doesn't want to play. So the concept that you're like, you should be doing stuff with your dog, and unfortunately, it doesn't work with at least a lot of the dogs that we've seen over the last 20 years.
When they're truly fearful.
Yeah.
Like, I keep reverting back to Burton because he's just the perfect example of all of these things. Like, that dog would eat food probably until he died.
Right.
He had such an appetite. He's a lab.
Yeah.
Thunderstorms. Would not take a piece of kibble or cheese, nothing.
Or any of your HVTs, high-value treats. So how do we get a dog over thunderstorms? What we do is this. We leverage obedience.
Mm-hmm.
And what does that mean? I'm going to put you in a down, and you're going to deal with this environmental. And if you break command and you absolutely know down, I'm actually going to correct you. Now, I'm not correcting you for being afraid. I'm correcting you for breaking command. So now... Oh, so you're just making the dog, you're forcing the dog to deal with it? Yeah. Yeah. And why do we do that? Because we have humongous success. But this is what most people do is, and I'm not saying we're heartless. We're far from heartless. Like, I actually love my dogs. And I want the best for my dogs.
Mm-hmm.
But I also don't want them to be nervous, fearful wrecks.
Or just in that flea state.
Yes.
Everybody probably, I'm sure, has seen a dog in the middle of a thunderstorm pacing around the house.
Yes.
Trying to hide.
Yep.
Trying to claw through. It's like, who wants to see their dog do that?
Dogs will go through walls.
And be calm and learn to cope. You just have to teach them how to cope with things.
So that's like your full immersion training, which actually, you know, if anybody studies like cognitive behavioral therapy, it's like, you know, there's a lot of similarities to that where you immerse the dog in certain situations, but with guidance.
Yes.
You're there.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I am there with you. I will help you. I will walk you through this. And then what happens is after a couple of sessions, we see the dog have more confidence and not be afraid of the environmental. That goes now onto the behavior spectrum, because a lot of people will say, my dog knows it down unless there's a big noise.
Yeah.
I'm like, but there's big noises everywhere.
Right.
Or my dog will hold command unless a stranger comes in the house. And this is a big one for me. I'm like, you let strangers in your house? Like, no. Like,
mm-hmm.
Almost everybody's a stranger to your dog.
Right.
So I think that, yes, obedience is important.
Mm-hmm.
But having a well-behaved dog is the most important thing in my book.
Yeah.
And the great thing about, you know, I still make phone calls to every potential client. And I always start off the phone call with like, listen, I don't need to know about all the good stuff. Just tell me what you're struggling with, because that's why they're really hiring us.
Mm-hmm.
But meanwhile, we'll make the good stuff even better. But I'm glad your dog knows all these commands. And there's a difference though. Somebody's down is different than our down.
Yeah.
Our down is you don't move for anything.
Right.
Their down is it downs until the food runs out or until it feels like it's getting up.
It's a party trick.
Right, exactly.
Sit down, roll over.
Exactly. It's not serious dog training. So I think it's important that folks understand also that they don't need a dog trainer to do this.
No.
Like, all this stuff can be done by you. You can either watch, let's talk about us for a second. You can either watch our free YouTube videos, or we do have a great course called Green to Graduate. The Green to Graduate, which we'll put a link up in the description of this, the Green to Graduate is a course we have. It's only $197, but we used actually a dog, that didn't even know its name. And we had it totally off-leash trained in 10 days. Like, literally off-leash trained. Now.
But, yeah, but anybody could.
Anybody could. It would probably take them maybe a month to do it. But,
yeah,
you know,
but you could do it faster if you really dedicate the time. Yeah. A couple hours a day of training, where most people probably only have 1 hour a day of training. If you want to put 2 hours a day of training in, you can easily have an off-leash trained dog in a couple of weeks.
Yep, you actually can. Now, the biggest issue, and this is for another real talk, is troubleshooting a lot of anxiety and fear and nervousness. I think we're going to devote a whole real talk to that, about what our formula is at the training center.
We should make a whole course on that.
Yeah.
Fearful dog.
Yeah.
A lot of people are struggling with that these days.
Yeah, I think we will, because that's, again, my dog is obedient.
Until
my dog is actually decently behaved, but it's so fearful, and we see so many of them. And lately, we've been seeing a lot of dogs that are really struggling. I call it upstairs. What it means is they're really struggling with their impulse control, where their neurotic behaviors, with their excessive whining, with their a lot of the fear and their anxiety and stress. Because a lot of people have been keeping these dogs sheltered and not exposing them to actually the real world. And from a very young age, you should be showing your dog lots of potential negative experiences so they can cope with them pretty much. But when you shelter these dogs and you want to keep them safe and nothing negative ever coming into their life, well, Mother Nature doesn't care about any of that stuff.
Yeah.
There's going to be bad stuff that comes in their life. And if a dog has not been exposed to those things, it could be a wreck for the rest of the day.
Mm-hmm. We've seen it.
But when you expose your dog to a lot of those things, it might all of a sudden have like a 3 second, like, oh shit, this sucks. But then it like
snaps
rebounds
back.
Yeah. Rebounds back.
Yep.
Yeah.
So true.
I think training obedience is so much fun. We have fun with it too.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot of fun to do it, especially with a dog that's driving.
Yeah.
Or a dog that wants to learn.
Yes.
It's fun. It's food. The dog is thrilled to work. You know, that's great. Now, the big thing is troubleshooting a dog that just doesn't want to work.
Oh, yeah. That's always fun.
And how do you get that dog motivated? Because some dogs literally just don't want to work.
They don't.
It's not got nothing to do with what we're doing. It's just in general.
No, it's like it could be their life. They've never been asked to do anything
ever
before. Right. And they're like, why would I start now?
Right, exactly. It's that pushback. It's that your kid is good. And I hate to humanize dogs because I don't. But it's like all the parents out there. It's like at 12 years old, your kid is good. And at 14, it's really disrespectful to you. It's like, with a lot of dog, why? Because you all of a sudden give it more responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
It's like the first time your kid starts dropping F-bombs at you or argues or slams a door or does whatever, it's like probably because you asked it to do something that it didn't want to do. Clean your room, do your own laundry, do the dishes,
mm-hmm.
take out the trash. You know, it's like family chores. And it's just like now you get pushback. Same with dogs.
Yep.
Same with dogs. So sure, the dog will lie down as a party trick, but it's like, no, you need to lie down around everything.
And for extended periods of time.
That's when you get pushback with your dog. And what does that look like? Sometimes they use their mouth on you.
Yep.
Sometimes they'll jump on you. Sometimes they'll growl at you. But it's like you have to do that to work the dog through it. And I'd rather set those scenarios up where we can be safe than experience them outside for the very, very first time.
So true.
First time.
Yeah.
So I think a lot of people need to take their dog training to the next level. And this whole narrative that you shouldn't ever go over threshold is a lie.
It's going to keep you stuck forever.
You start at the basics. But when it's time to start really training your dog so you can take it everywhere, almost all the training is above threshold.
Yeah.
Because Mother Nature doesn't give a shit about thresholds.
Human beings every day are pushed beyond thresholds.
Oh my gosh.
I'm terrified of airplanes. Guess what? I travel on an airplane at least once a month.
Yeah. It used to be every week.
It's like you just have to do it. And the more you do it, the easier it gets. Now instead of hyperventilating and freaking out on the airplane, I can at least breathe through it.
Right.
And I've learned coping mechanisms.
Right.
It's the same for dogs.
Right.
Like they just have to learn how
to
deal.
I don't know if this is the exact same example, but you haven't been feeling well this morning, you know? But you still went to the gym.
Mm-hmm.
And And then when you got back, you sort of were like, you know, I'm really sluggish, not feeling really well. And I'm like, well, we recorded five videos, thanking people for joining our inner circle. And now we're doing this. Now, if you have never pushed yourself before through any sort of like adversity or stress or stuff like that, like there's so many people that are like, I'm not feeling well, I'm done for the day.
Yeah.
It's like, but life goes on.
Mm-hmm.
Life goes on. So it's just like, are you absolutely 100% thrilled that we're doing this? Probably not, but your work ethic says you've got to do it. And also, you've done so much over your years of life that you've worked no matter what. Unless you're totally flat on your ass.
Yeah.
You know,
even then, I'm still like, I can edit a video.
Right. Yeah. Even then, you're like, I can't waste my time here. It's like, I can edit videos in between throwing up. You know what I mean? True. So I think that it's important, but because that was instilled at you from a very young age.
Yeah. If my parents hadn't, I can't imagine what I would be like now as an adult.
Right.
Some lazy fuck.
Well, we're not going there, but well, when you can talk about you personally, yes, you would be a lazy fuck, but we won't talk about, like, you know, what's going on with people in 2022. So I think it's really, really important that people start understanding, yes, obedience, train your dog, reward-based system, proof the obedience, correctional-based system, and you set your dog up into situations where it's probably going to fail just so you can actually educate the dog that breaking the command or not doing the command is a wrong choice. You do not have a selective listener. You do not have a stubborn dog.
Yeah.
You are actually a trainer, and we're all trainers, even owners,
yep,
who just are not enforcing the rules enough and probably not applying a correction for lack of compliance. When it comes to good behavior, step one is always, historically, of stopping an unwanted behavior, is always a no. It's always step one. It's a no. Now, after that,
give the dog a chance again to do the thing.
Right.
If they don't do it, reward.
Yes. Or
so it's very black and white.
Or on a lot of behaviors, what is the reward? Not correcting the dog.
Yeah.
Believe it or not, the lack of correction can be the reward. Because I'm not going to correct my dog for everything it does. Here's a great example. What's the reward for our dogs bringing the ball back from the ocean? We throw it again for them.
Yeah.
That's the reward. I'm not going to hold up another ball so they drop that ball and throw that ball. It's like, no.
Right.
There's one in your mouth. You bring it to me and you drop it.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, that is, at least for, I know for a lot of people's dogs, playing chuck it, frisbee, swimming, hiking, running off leash.
It's the ultimate reward.
That's the ultimate reward.
You get to come everywhere with me.
Yeah. And that's what we want. That
you're
is why
just,
we're,
you're
yeah.
not just confined to the backyard.
I think a lot of the whole motivation behind Real Talk is, so we want you to be able to take your dogs everywhere.
Yeah.
That's what it goal. Is. That's what it is.
It's just funny because, like, you know, before I got into working with you and just, like, dogs in general, you know, I'd see all these well-behaved dogs out, and, like, Bert was one of them, you
yep,
know.
Yep.
Oh, like, but it's, like, we get in, and, you know, I just think, like, oh, those are just good dogs. Like, that's why they are the way they are.
Right.
We get in some of the most nervous, fearful, aggressive dogs. I feel like that's all we ever get in. It's very rare.
Well,
we
that's where
happy-go-lucky labs and stuff.
That's what we're known for.
And every single one of them has impeccable public access skills by the time they go home.
We show it.
So your average pet dog can do what our dogs do.
Yeah.
That's the thing. Everyone makes it seem like it's this impossible feat,
right,
but it's not.
Like we're magicians or we've got some magic touch. Now, obviously,
we even had dogs that, like, I'm like, I don't know how far we're going to get with you. And they still, by the end, are going to cafes with us and, like, doing some really cool
things.
Now,
obviously, you and I and our staff, we have a skill set. Because why we've just worked with so many dogs with so many different temperaments, personalities, behavioral issues. And we've had to troubleshoot so many dogs. So, but that's why we also offer online consults, this inner circle that we're doing, free Q&As, because a lot of people are doing a great job with their dog, but there's still a couple of little tweaks that they need.
Yeah.
And that's why we've got everything from free to paid as well. And I think it's really, really important that people understand, it's like, Like, you know what? Don't be satisfied with half-assery.
Yeah.
Don't be satisfied with like, oh, my dog's too old to learn, or my dog can't get better. I mean, is your dog going to be a competition, you know, dog?
It doesn't need to be,
but,
though.
But yeah, it's a family pet dog.
You need to recall and walk nicely on a leash, so it can pretty much do 90% of things with you then.
Yes.
If you have those two basic things,
yes.
Walking on a leash and a recall, the world is your oyster. You can pretty much do anything you want.
And not being a jerk.
Yeah.
For the dog, not to be a jerk.
Let's talk about the inner circle, because you just mentioned it.
Oh, sure.
So the inner circle is our new group coaching class that we're going to be starting. June 6th is the first one. We're currently, doors are open. You can't buy it all the time. You can only buy it during the certain windows that we open the doors, because we want everyone to obviously join at the same time and go through the course at the same time. So we don't want people joining at all random times.
But it's limited too, to how many people.
We do limit it to like 8 to 10 people. And it's exactly for this. Like, if you have a trained dog, let's say, but it still is doing some, you know, not so good behaviors, counter surfing or lunging on the leash, things like that. It's open to those who've been through our Green to Graduate and Leash Reactivity course. And you still just need like a little extra help, a little guidance, us kind of peeking over your shoulder.
Troubleshooting.
That's what this course is for. And you can send us videos and we'll watch you train and we'll walk you through the whole process, like step by step.
Yep.
And it's going to be amazing. The first class starts June 6th. Doors are open right now. Enrollment is open. And you can join through the link that I will post below in the show notes.
Right. Now, why are we making it that Green to Graduate and Leash Reactivity are prerequisites, though?
I think this is the first thing we've ever done prerequisites for. It's because it's going to be pretty detailed. It's going to be deeper than any YouTube video or thing you've seen out there.
Right.
We want you to have a pretty good understanding of dog training and have very clear goals in mind that we can help you with.
Right.
It's not going to be like the Q&A podcast where you ask any and every question. This is going to be very detailed. We're going to give you homework. It's going to be great. We'll be able to walk you through everything.
I think it's also because the inner circle is not set up for people to be like, how do I teach my dog to do a downstay?
Right.
It's like, that's why we're making these prerequisites.
Yes.
All right. Let's wind this all up, because we can talk about this all day long, but let's wind this all up. Everything that we have described, everything from the minute we turned on record to right now, both correcting and rewarding, it builds a better relationship with your dog. It builds a bond with your dog that you probably never knew you can have.
Yeah.
And a lot of what we have talked about, especially from the correction side, the narrative out there, especially on social media, with trainers, with vets, with behaviorists, it's like, no. A lot of that stuff actually destroys the relationship. Ironically, we have never seen that in 20 years.
Never.
And 10,000 dogs. All these supposeds that are supposed to be happening, I'm still waiting for them to happen.
Yeah.
They're not happening.
Mm-mm.
All we hear about is people, even if people don't hire us, but they watch our free content, they're getting great results. Now, if you don't get a good result, it's possible that you should be looking at the teacher, not at the student. It's possible that you worked too fast. But in general, if you follow our programs, especially the Green to Graduate program, which is right now our number one selling program. And it is, you'll have a dog that you're like, I can't believe I was able to do this with my dog.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's pretty awesome.
Yeah, it really, really is. Well, anyway, thank you for joining us on episode 3 of Real Talk with Jeff and Joelle. And we will see you next show.
Yeah.
I guess we have to work on an outro.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right.
We'll post all the links to everything we talked about, though, in the show notes.
Excellent. Love you guys. All right. Bye-bye.